Good to have you with us. You're watching The Big Story. I'm Avni Raja. Let's start with the state of Maharashtra, where there is still an uphill battle with respect to COVID cases. After successfully tackling the Dharavi challenge in Mumbai, now the challenge has shifted to the neighborhood of Mumbai and the greater Mumbai area, in fact, where several satellite towns are facing a large spike in COVID cases. From poor testing to lack of medical infrastructure and a sharp spike in cases, the MMR region is in a precarious situation at this point in time. After being ignored all this time, the authorities are now racing against time to actually try and solve the problem and stop the spread of coronavirus cases. In fact, first, let's understand the importance and the significance of these satellite towns that are in Mumbai's neighborhood. Apurva joins me for more details. Apurva, help us understand, you know, how important these satellite towns really are.
Absolutely, Anavni. It's quite ironic because we're looking at the Mumbai metropolitan region, which is a very significant area, which constitutes several of the areas like the Meera Bhayandar. It has Thane, Dombivli, Kalyan, Navi Mumbai. All of these areas are extremely significant, yet it is one of the regions which has been neglected at all times. The reason why the Mumbai metropolitan region is so important is because it is India's largest industrialized belt. Not just that, it in fact constitutes 1.6 crore of the population in three of the districts, which includes Thane, Palghar and Raigarh. In fact, looking at this entire region, it is also very important to note here that it houses several of the IT and manufacturing hubs as well. Several of the key industrial units are also housed in the Mumbai metropolitan region, which is one of the reasons why it is a preferred destination for the migrants, and it also serves as a major workforce for the migrant community, giving them the jobs in these areas because of the industrialization, because of the industrial units that are located in this particular region. Also, it provides 40% of the population, in fact, travel to Mumbai. So we're looking at 40% of the people who are living in this in these areas, in fact, commute to Mumbai on a daily basis. So this really accounts to the reasons why this particular region, the Mumbai metropolitan region, is so important. It is a workforce, it is a work hub for a lot of migrants who come to this area. And yet, it is one of the areas which has been neglected at all times, Avni.
Yes, absolutely, Apurva. That is, in fact, extremely important points to keep in mind that majority of the workforce from this area comes to Mumbai. So if the satellite towns are in trouble, it's only a matter of time before, you know, the number of cases once again reach Mumbai as well. Apurva, thanks for joining us with those details. But let's delve a little bit more into some of these specific areas and what's the kind of issues that are being faced over there. Let's talk about Panvel, in fact, first, which is struggling as COVID cases rise. Currently, the city is facing a massive crunch in infrastructure. There are not enough beds that are available. In fact, government hospitals have only about 450 beds at this point in time. And the government has taken over about 600 beds from private hospitals as well. And at this point, all of these beds are utilized. So that means that there are no free beds that are there at this point in time in Panvel. The officials say managing with up to 65 ICUs and 30 ventilators in government hospitals has become a very critical challenge as cases are on the rise. Meanwhile, Miranao's Neha Kulkarni spoke to Panvel resident Gopichand Kharat, who narrated his harrowing experience of hospital hunting in his locality when his mother was infected with COVID-19 and needed immediate admission into the hospital. Listen in to his ordeal.
मेरे मम्मी को ऑक्सीजन की कमतरता थी. मैं पनवेल में ऐसा कौन सा हॉस्पिटल नहीं है कि मैं वो हॉस्पिटल में जाके आया हूँ कि सब यहाँ पे यही एक ऑप्शन है कि आप हमारे यहाँ पे ऑक्सीजन बेड अवेलेबल नहीं है और आपके पेशेंट से आप कोविड-19 टेस्ट करवाइए. मैं डॉक्टर लोगों से बात की कि कोविड-19 ऐसा टेस्ट है कि उसको दो दिन तीन दिन लगते हैं रिपोर्ट आने के लिए. आप प्लीज़ करके मेरे मम्मी को आप एडमिट कीजिए हॉस्पिटल में. और दूसरी बात ये कि टेस्ट आने के बाद मैं कोविड-19 टेस्ट कर रहा हूँ क्योंकि यहाँ पे हॉस्पिटल में ऐसा चालू है कि कोई कौन सा ही पेशेंट हॉस्पिटल में नहीं ले जा रहा है क्योंकि वो निगेटिव रहें दो या पॉजिटिव रहें दो, ये यहाँ की पनवेल की परिस्थिति है.
तो आप बताइए कि आपको उस दिन कितना ऑक्सीजन की उनको गरज पड़ गई, तो कितना आपको मेहनत करनी पड़ी, क्या क्या पिया आपने?
मेरे मम्मी को जब भी ऑक्सीजन की गरज थी तो तभी मैं 6 से 7 घंटा यहाँ पनवेल में घूम चुका हूँ मेरे गाड़ी में लेके, कि ऐसा कौन सा हॉस्पिटल नहीं था कि डायरेक्टली उनको बोला कि बाबा चलो हम लोग आपको आपको बेड दे रहे, ये भी डॉक्टर की कोई ये नहीं, फैसिलिटी नहीं है।
सरकारी अस्पतालों ने क्या बोला?
सरकारी हॉस्पिटल में यही वो उन्होंने बोला कि हमारे पास बेड अवेलेबल नहीं है और ऑक्सीजन बेड नहीं है, तो फिर पेशेंट को लेके क्या कहाँ पे जाइए?
In fact, Mirana also spoke to the Navi Mumbai Civic Body chief over the issues as far as Greater Mumbai is concerned. He accepted that there are serious issues and that there are lapses as far as Navi Mumbai area is concerned. And of course, remember, this area was depending on Mumbai for testing. There was no lab of its own. And that also, he admitted, was a problem. Listen in.
The wait of 3 months for us to have even a testing lab in Navi Mumbai. What was the reason of so much of delay? And now that it's happening, because people are already complaining, it's taking more than 3-4 days to even get the result samples. So what is the reason that so much delay was caused?
Maybe the approach so far has been to depend more on the labs which are there in Mumbai, like Hapkin and NIV, as well as what information I could gather, corporation has entered into an agreement with few private labs. But as I mentioned, private labs have got their own problems. They have a limited setup. Then private lab doesn't work for exclusively for one corporation area. While if we got our own testing labs, then that could be exclusive to our area. Mm-hmm. And this is the difference between private and government lab. So it is about maybe the approach through which we look at the problem. But I'm very sure that if we start our own labs, this issue can be taken care of.
A lot of complaints from coming from patients about hospitals are charging a bomb and there is no method to complain or even raise a query about it. Like many other corporations are having a formula or having any system. What is the system in place in Navi Mumbai?
So the issue is about enforcement. So first of all, as a response to whatever complaints we are receiving, or proactively making it compulsory for hospitals to display that how many beds are there, how many are occupied, how many are vacant, this may bring about some transparency. We are going to start an online portal as well, which will give a real-time information about available beds in both government as well as private facilities. This will bring about some change in terms of transparency about availability of beds. And ultimately, it depends on supply of beds. As and when we are in a position to make more number of beds available automatically, this issue will be taken care of.
Don't you think there is a delay happening in the portal and the lab which you're planning to have? This is something which Mumbai had 3 months back. This is something which other corporations have had for a long period of time. Why has Navi Mumbai been behind?
See, this is a continuous process. Delay certainly is there in some of the aspects, and definitely that cannot be denied. But then this is a continuous process. Given that situation is like this today, what measures we are going to take, that is what I'm telling you about. Mm-hmm. And as far as testing lab is concerned, availability of beds is concerned, or enforcement about exorbitant charges being imposed by private hospital is concerned, we are very serious about it, and whole corporation machinery has been activated, and we are very sure that within next few days, we should be able to show result.
Meanwhile, let's just talk about India as a whole. Now we've crossed 10 lakh COVID cases in total. Now active cases of that number is just about one third. However, there are areas which are once again seeing a resurgence in cases, areas which have saw a successful handling of the COVID battle earlier, but however, now have seen a sudden spike in cases, and that has resulted to many states going ahead and going back into lockdown mode, especially in the urban areas, in the cities. So let me go across to Apurva to understand which are these areas which have gone back into lockdown mode, the return of the lockdown really, across several states is what we are seeing at the moment. Apurva, take us through those details.
Absolutely, Avni, as the number of cases has risen, many states have now gone into the lockdown mode. We'll just quickly take you through some of the details and the states that have gone. Starting with Maharashtra, where we're looking at the rise in the number of cases. Now, districts such as Thane is in lockdown till July 19th, Kalyan Dombivli till July 19th again, Meera Bhayandar again till July 18th, Pune till from 18th to 23rd of July, and Raigad till July 24th. Now, shifting to Karnataka, which is also another state where we have seen a number of cases that have been reported. In fact, before that, let me quickly toss back to Avni. We have some news that's coming in at this point.
All right, big breaking news that's coming in at the moment. This is the latest in the Rajasthan political crisis. Now, Sachin Pilot's council says that seeking a change of chief minister but not a change of government, and that an internal disagreement doesn't amount to defection. So that's the word that's coming in from Sachin Pilot's council as far as this matter is concerned. It is in court currently. The High Court is hearing a plea by the Rebel Congress MLAs. And this is the argument that has been put forth, saying that they're seeking a change of the chief minister, but not a change as far as the government itself is concerned. And an internal disagreement that Sachin Pilot and the MLAs, his supporters have with the government doesn't amount to defection, but it is just a disagreement. Those are the details coming in at this point in time. Remember, this is the third plea that is now being heard as far as the Rajasthan political crisis is concerned. The Congress maintained that the court has cannot intervene in this matter of the notice until and unless the speaker takes a decision on disqualification. However, Sachin Pilot has in fact his plea says that is questioning the very notice that has been put forth given by the speaker over disqualification to him and his supporter MLAs as well. And now, of course, this is going to be a crucial hearing because it talks about the constitutional validity of the speaker's notice. And we'll, of course, have to wait and watch what the High Court says as far as this issue is concerned. So at this point in time, those are the details coming in. Pilot's counsel saying that this is seeking a change of chief minister, not government. Meenakshi joining us on the phone line. Meenakshi, these are some important points coming in. The argument that is being put forth at this point in time from Sachin Pilot side, saying that this is not does not amount to defection because it is only a disagreement, and also that they're seeking a change of chief minister but not of government.
Input coming in, Avni, from the Rajasthan High Court matter is being argued very much as we speak, and no less than Mr. Harish Salve lending his mic to the cause of Sachin Pilot and the 18 MLAs. Very, very pertinent points emerging. For the first time, we're seeing Sachin Pilot break his silence via his counsel. And he's saying this, essentially, that there is no aspect of defection which is involved here. Raising disagreements regarding the dictatorial functioning of a chief minister is only an internal matter and doesn't amount to defection. This is what Sachin Pilot is saying in the Rajasthan High Court via Mr. Harish Salve. Asking for a change of chief minister does not amount to asking for a change of government. This is another point. And the third important point that Mr. Salve is contending as we speak before the Rajasthan High Court is this, that any act committed outside the state or outside the House, beg your pardon, or the Assembly is something that does not fall within the ambit of the Speaker's powers under 10th schedule. And therefore, the Speaker has no jurisdiction to issue a notice and demand responses of Mr. Sachin Pilot and 18 MLAs. So clearly, Sachin Pilot digging his heels deep. Remember, this is coming soon after certain reports of Mr. Pilot to the media, where he clarified that as of now, he has no intentions of joining the BJP. But this is the first time he's breaking his silence in this hearing via Mr. Harish Salve, where he's saying that internal disagreement over the dictatorial functioning of a chief minister is an internal matter. It does not amount to defection. Second point, he's saying that asking for a change of chief minister does not amount to asking for a change of government. And a third important point that Mr. Salvi has argued thus far is how any act which is committed outside the House or outside the Assembly falls outside the ambit of the 10 scheduled powers of the Speaker that has been invoked. Also, one more point we are getting as we speak, because the matter is ongoing. Remember, a very high-stake matter being argued before the division bench of the Rajasthan High Court, where Mr. Harish Salve raises the issue of freedom of speech of legislators. He submits that the disqualification notice is an attempt to stifle freedom of speech and internal discussions. So very, very, challenging arguments are being made by Sachin Pilot. Clearly, he is in no mood to relent. And he is again saying that there is absolutely no aspect of defection which can be invoked, because all that he was doing was raising questions on the dictatorial style of functioning of a chief minister. And asking for a change of chief minister doesn't amount to asking for a change of government. Abhi.
Yes, absolutely, Meenakshi. Some extremely pertinent points there that you're bringing to us about what's going on in court. And it's going to be very interesting to see how this really plays out and what are the court's observations as far as all of these issues are concerned. Strong arguments, obviously, there coming in as well, talking about the fact where Pilots Council is talking about the fact that this is an internal agreement and disagreement, I beg your pardon, and it does not amount to defection. And they're seeking a change as far as the chief minister is concerned, but not of the government. So those are two important points that are coming in. This is, of course, gives insight into the way the Sachin Pilot is approaching this whole thing at the moment. Remember, this is now the third plea that is being heard as far as the Rajasthan political crisis is concerned. And this is also important because it's going to look at the constitutional validity of the Speaker's notice of disqualification to Sachin Pilot and 18 of his MLAs. So, of course, we'll have to wait and see how this really plays out and what it means. The other interesting aspect here to also look out for is the fact that today is the deadline for Sachin Pilot and the MLAs to actually reply to the Speaker's notice as well. But obviously, that will depend on the outcome of this hearing and the validity of that notice itself, which will determine whether or not they file that notice with the Speaker as well. So those are some important things to watch out for at this point in time as far as Rajasthan is concerned, and all of these issues regarding Sachin Pilot and the rest of the Congress party is also concerned. Congress party meanwhile has maintained that the court cannot intervene into this matter right now until and unless the Speaker comes to a decision on disqualification. All right, we've got Meenakshi back with us. So Meenakshi, this is also going to be interesting, like I was pointing out, because today is also the deadline for Sachin Pilot and his MLA, supporter MLAs to file their response or their reply to the notice that has been given by the Speaker. But once again, that will be determined and dependent on what happens in court with respect to the validity of that notice itself. All right, we seem to have lost Meenakshi, but of course, we will keep track. We will be keeping track of all the details at this point in time. In fact, those are the details that are coming in at this point as far as Rajasthan is concerned. The Sachin Pilot's Council saying that this is seeking a change of chief minister, not of government, and this is an internal disagreement that doesn't amount to defection. Those are the details that are coming in. Also, we're picking up the no power of speaker for acts outside the assembly. So this is what is the other issue. The Pilot's Council also raising the issue of free speech of MLAs. Those are the details. We're going to slip into a very quick break and come back with more. News that's coming in, this is a horrifying incident. The owner of a sweet shop was shot dead in broad daylight by assailants in Ghaziabad. This happened last afternoon. CCTV grab, in fact, which we're going to put up for you on your screen, shows the assailant along with the accomplice pointing a gun at the sweet shop owner. As you can see on your screens, the assailant, both of them are absconding at the moment, and Ghaziabad cops have filed a murder case. Those are the visuals there on your screen of the gun there being pointed at the sweet shop owner. Well, moving on now, this is a fresh controversy that has broken out. The family of Vikas Dubey's slain aide has alleged that he was a minor. However, UP police has rejected this charge. The aide's family has made his high school mark sheet and Aadhaar card public to support their claim. Both the documents mention his date of birth as May 27th, 2004. Now, according to the police, the accused was arrested but shot dead in retaliatory firing after he allegedly snatched a pistol from a policeman and fired at the personnel escorting him. And more news that's coming in. This is reports coming in. As per Pakistan media, the country has offered a third consular access to India for Kulbhushan Jadhav. To India's demand to have not a security personnel during the meeting. Details that are coming in. The country offering a third consular access to India for Kulbhushan Jadhav.